Good evening, all. Where there is much desire to learn, there of necessity will be much arguing, much writing, many opinions, for opinion of good men and women, I might add, is but knowledge in the making. That's a quote from my favorite 17th century poet, John Milton. That's what we will be doing today, and my hope is that we'll go beyond that, and that we will have some concrete, actionable proposals from our speakers. I'm putting the heat on. After all, as the Karl Marx Memorial in London puts it, the philosophers have only interpreted the world in various ways. The point, however, is to change it. I plan to be a benevolent despot today. Each panelist will have 5 minutes to make their opening remarks focused on solutions. I'm making one exception for Carrie Gelson, that is. She's going to get 6 minutes. My prerogative. At the end, they will also have 2 minutes each to wrap things up. In between, though, I will have some questions in a moderated session with the panelists for about 15 minutes, where I hope to bring some heat to the discussion. And then we will have audience questions, audience participation, including from Twitter. And on the questions front, each of them will have 2 minutes to answer the questions. They have to be disciplined. Don't worry, I am going to make sure that that happens. Just to frame this conversation with some basic facts, it's not just children living in poverty, it is families living in poverty. Median household incomes in British Columbia is about $68,000 and change. The average household is carrying a debt load of $1.60 for every dollar in income. We have some of the highest housing costs in the country. Retirement income of many British Columbians are threatened because of low returns for bonds and equity portfolios. So clearly it's not good times. The definition of the problem is important. Poverty rates in BC have declined by around 45% since 2003, from 19.2% to 10.5%. You arrive at that number by calculating the income and transfers effect, and then when you net out, that's the number you arrive at. So we still have a 10.5% poverty rate, entirely too much for a rich country like ours. How can children on an empty stomach, scratching themselves because they've been bitten by bedbugs, completely unprepared for care, learn anything? They aren't making it. They are dropping out. Scratch that. They are, in fact, being pushed out. The Vancouver Sun decided to have an adopt-a-school program after Carrie's story, which appeared in our paper, which has raised over $1.5 million so far. And the money has been distributed to 40 inner-city schools. I hate that term, inner-city. I think we should just say any school. The money has provided for breakfast programs for hungry children and provided emergency food vouchers for many of those families. It has paid for field trips, giving them access to new technology, playgrounds, and winter clothing. I want to thank all the Sun readers and many of you here for helping us help kids. But the problems affecting our kids are multifaceted. They require a multi-pronged approach. Schools and teachers alone cannot do it. They cannot solve the problem, nor can we by ourselves at the Vancouver Sun. But together, though, we have a chance. So let's get to our panelists. We have Paul Kershaw of UBC, who has spent an enormous amount of intellectual capital on issues of children, poverty, and learning. Carrie Gelson is an exceptional teacher at Seymour Elementary. We are lucky that she is in the teaching profession. Then we have Bruce Ralston, who is the NDP MLA for Surrey Wally. He co-chaired the NDP's election platform, important point. A lawyer by training, but I find him to be a very thoughtful individual. That's a compliment, Bruce.
Raising expectations already.
That's right. Ralph Sultan is a long-serving Liberal MLA for West Vancouver, Capilano. He's an economist by training, so I like him. As an economics degree myself, and was Minister of State for Seniors. So without further ado, you did not come here to listen to me. You came here to listen to the experts. So Paul Kershaw. Paul, the floor is yours.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am here to tell you that poverty is a tale of two stories in our country and in our province. Sorry about that. The first story is a good news story. A generation ago, nearly 30% of seniors in this province were poor. But we've made changes and we've managed to wrestle that poverty rate down to around 8% today, lower than any other age group in the province and country. The second story is a bad news story. Over that exact same period of time, families headed by people under the age of 25, or 25 to 34, or 35 to 44 have all witnessed their rates of poverty increase dramatically. And so the question is, how do we go about emulating our success story and avoiding the failure? So let's figure out what went right for seniors. The first thing is, over that period of time, since 1976, our economy has doubled in size. It produces an extra 35 grand per household today. Times are not as tough as Fazil just implied. For those who had homes decades ago, we have seen great changes happen. The rise in housing prices over 150% means far more wealth for those who had homes decades ago. But the same high housing prices are crushing the dreams of homeownership for many younger folks and weighing them down with heavy levels of debt. It's not just those changes in our economic and social environment that have made a difference for seniors. It's also how we collectively used our prosperity as a province and country. Today, compared to 1976, we spend an extra $50 billion a year to ensure that seniors don't go broke when they wind up sick at a hospital. And we've added an extra $30 billion a year to the Canada Public Pension Plan and Old Age Security to ensure seniors don't have as much economic insecurity as in the past. And it's important. That's my mom. She's a retiree, and I want her to have a healthy, happy, secure retirement. But my mom was surprised to learn that over that same period of time, we have not raised at all the investments we put into younger generations when they have young kids, which creates a pretty interesting, and I would dare say, worrisome age pattern when it comes to looking at our social spending. Each year, we spend around $45,000 per retiree, compared to just $12,000 per person under the age of 45, which includes spending for kindergarten to grade 12, post-secondary, and medical care. But outside of school and medical care, most of our spending on younger adults and kids tends to focus on only the low income in those generations. And when we focus on the poor, we tend to be stingy because we worry if the benefits are set too high, people will opt for welfare over work. And so instead, we ask a typical lone mom with a toddler to get by on $5,000 of income for a year after covering housing and routine health. A fraction of what more generous countries do, and they have better poverty rates. We have two tales of poverty reduction strategies, one focusing on the poor in a generation, one focusing on entire generations. Clearly, the latter has been more successful. So if you want to leave this room to reduce child poverty, then we as a province and a country need to adapt for generation squeeze in the way that we have done and continue to do for retirees. That means looking for Gen X and Gen Y at things that are happening for the typical person in that generation. They're earning $4 less an hour today compared to 1976, even though they're more than twice as likely to have some kind of post-secondary education and the much higher student debt that comes with it today. And then they have to pay for housing prices that are $350,000 higher. Worse still, that squeeze tightens when people want to start their own families. When couples take advantage of our parental leave system, they forego $15,000 from their after-tax income to share a year at home with a new baby. And since you can't take that income hit for very long, and you need to rely on services so that you can have time in the labor market to fend off lower wages and higher costs of living, you have young families looking for things like childcare. But they can't find them, there's not enough spaces, and most of those spaces cost more than university at the very moment young people were hoping they could pay down their student debts. But we can change this. Here's the concrete stuff. If you think it's a problem that it's so unaffordable for many young families to share a year at home with a new baby, then let's change it. Let's make our parental leave system better. Let's make it more generous. Let's make it more inclusive of the self-employed. And let's lengthen it so that dads can get more involved without compromising the fact that dads are not good breastfeeders. And in the process, let's set a minimum benefit akin to today's maximum, and we'll eliminate poverty for families with very young kids. And if you don't like the fact that we can't find childcare services and they're more costly than university, well, let's build them and invest in them to bring the cost down to $10 a day. And for households with incomes below $40,000, no fee, to minimize their barrier to employment. For the typical family, that would save them $50,000 by the time their kids reach age 6, with which they could then afford better work-life balance, to pay down their student debt, to reduce by years the time it takes to save a down payment or to save for their retirement. We'll simultaneously cut by 3/4 the number of kids who are actually poor, and with the existing dollars that are left in our anti-poverty measures, we can do more for those who remain poor, tripling the National Child Benefit Supplement and increasing by 50% the shelter allowance for those who are on welfare with kids, which would take that lone mom with a toddler from about $5,000 to in the top 5 countries internationally. And we'd eliminate poverty for families with young kids. And the cost? Not as much as you think. It would simply require raising the allocation per person under the age of 45 in this country and in this province from $12,000 a year to $13,000, while leaving spending per retiree about where it is now. My last point, here's the problem. On the center left and on the center right, both of the platforms represented here tonight do the opposite. They add an extra $1,000 per retiree and a fraction for those who are younger, growing the gap between generations. So I ask people here tonight, join us at the Gen Squeeze campaign to help push for all parties to stop pitting the health of grandparents against the well-being of their kids and grandchildren. Join us to give all generations a chance.
Thank you, Paul. I have to admit, though, that Paul and I have been accused in the past by critics that we want to start a generation warfare. I'll tell you right now, we don't intend to do that. And that's not our intent. Carrie Gelson.
You know, when you work with kids, that minutes are, you know, long minutes and short minutes, so I get 6 long minutes, Fazil. So good evening, everybody, and thank you so much for being here tonight. My name is Carrie Gelson, and I teach at Admiral Seymour Elementary, about 12 or so blocks east of here. We're a tiny little inner-city school on the downtown east side. I've taught at Seymour since 1995, so I've spent a big chunk of most days every year for the past 18 years with young students who are surrounded by and living in poverty. A classroom is a really intimate, tight-knit community. I have a front-row seat to the impact that poverty has on children. Child poverty rates in BC are unacceptable. That 1 child in 7 lives in poverty in this province is shameful. Of course, where I teach, poverty rates are much higher than 1 in 7, so my outrage is magnified. We're here tonight to explore answers and solutions to child poverty, but the fact that so many children and families in this province live in poverty is not about a lack of answers or solutions. Those answers do exist. Child poverty in BC is a choice that we all make. It's not a choice to live in poverty, of course, but it's a choice to let it continue at rates that really lead the country. For change to happen, we need to change our attitudes about inequity, about government responsibility, and about respectful social policy. I could easily spend the next 5 minutes, I'm guessing, that I have here, giving examples of why poverty is so hurtful and harmful to the children that are in my classroom and in classrooms all over this province. I have 18 years of daily stories, stories about neediness that interrupts learning, of sad and stressed children, of children arriving at school in dirty clothes, hungry, tired, sick, of language delay, high impulsivity, poor attention span, extreme lack of confidence, academic struggles and lack of supports, and the challenges that we face trying to get supports for our children when crises happen, and of the deep impact of generational poverty. But we're here tonight to explore solutions, and I have 3 main points I want to make. First, children and families must be lifted above the poverty line. This is just non-negotiable. We're talking about income measures and social policy that is respectful and reflects the costs and realities of raising healthy families. policies that allow families access to the labor market, paying people a living wage, implementing a $10 a day childcare plan, creating more flexible parental leave, increasing rates of social assistance, and increasing access to safe, secure, and adequate housing units. Without adopting these measures that are outlined and costed by organizations like First Call, the Canadian Center for Policy Alternatives, the Poverty Reduction Coalition, Paul Kershaw, children will continue to be negatively impacted in all aspects of their lives by poverty. My second point speaks to vulnerability. Vulnerability rates of the children that are arriving at school in kindergarten. These rates are well documented by the data that the late Dr. Clyde Hertzman and his team at UBC, the Human Early Learning Partnership, collected. A family's socioeconomic situation is the strongest predictor of a child's vulnerability. Overall, across various domains, physical, social, emotional, language, and cognitive ability. In schools like mine, where concentrated poverty exists, a high vulnerable neighborhood, if you will, 55 to 70% of the children arrive at school behind where we would like them to be, before they've even started. And even though a focus on the early years is not a new concept, Dr. Hertzman's data reveals that overall vulnerability in our youngest learners is rising, not declining. Sometimes I look at these little five-year-olds who show up for kindergarten in September, and I wish that we could snap our fingers and certain things would be solved. Years of nutritional diets would be guaranteed. Teeth would be healthy. Language exposure would not be so limited. The million-word deficit by age four for children living in poor homes would not exist. They would have heard nursery rhymes and fairy tales and night after night of bedtime stories. They would have been at the beach and know about spring flowers and had various experiences that increased their school readiness. We would not be struggling to find supports for physical or mental health issues that are overrepresented in poorer neighborhoods because of prenatal exposure to drugs or alcohol, violence in the home, years of homelessness. But I don't have that magical ability to do this, and neither does any other teacher that I know. So BC children need a government that invests in the early years through child and family policy, high quality, accessible, affordable childcare spaces, early learning opportunities, and policies that will give parents and caregivers more time with their children. All of these things are essential. Any investment we make in the early years pays for itself in the long run. Yes, we can talk economic return, but it's really about giving all children a more equitable chance. It's about children's rights, and it's about who we are as a society. There was a fantastic piece by Sean Reardon, a professor at Stanford, in the New York Times on April 27th. It was titled, No Rich Child Left Behind. It was part of a series on inequality, and it talks about the not surprising fact that family income is the best predictor of children's success at school. One line stuck out to me. Let's invest in parents so they can better invest in their children. Reardon, when discussing ways to address this growing inequity, referenced better government support for maternity and paternity leaves, expanding and improving preschool and childcare. Familiar suggestions, of course, because where we have children living in poverty and extreme inequity like we do in BC, we have the same types of solutions and the same lamenting. Why don't we get on with the doing of some of these things and pass just the talking about them? My final point is that we must develop an understanding that poverty is stress-inducing and develop better levels of responsive service. Children in poverty experience extreme levels of stress, exhausting levels of stress. We need to be very clear about what poverty does to children. Part of my job every day is accepting that a certain level of general upset will exist, crying, shutting down, mental health concerns in 7 and 8-year-olds. While the current levels of child poverty persist, this is an issue. If we were to adopt a poverty reduction strategy and actually see families lifted out of poverty, this will remain an issue for many of our children. The horrible residual effects. The poverty might disappear, but the vulnerability will remain for years. Poverty has cost us. It has hurt our children. Erasing the impact of poverty is not just going to be about income. So as we talk solutions, we need to talk about mental health supports, counseling, various therapies for children who need additional service to manage a myriad of anxieties and emotions. If I had more time here, I would like to stress the importance of coordination of service across ministries between health, education, and the Ministry of Children and Families, putting in place place-based services where they're most needed, nurse practitioners in schools, developmental pediatricians having office hours at community centers. But my time is winding up, and so I will finish with this final thought. The well-being of children is everybody's business. Child poverty rates are most deeply felt in the children that experience poverty and the families who bear witness. But we all pay the price for not doing enough to look after our children. Thank you.
Thank you, Carrie. And you would all agree with me that all of them have stuck to the script, i.e. to come up with solutions, so which is the good news. Thank you. Now for a thoughtful response, Bruce Ralston.
Great. Thanks very much, and thank you to SFU Public Square for holding this forum. It's certainly impressive on a night when I'm sure Leaf fans are somewhat morose. And thank you very much for coming and participating. I represent a riding in Surrey, North Surrey, and although perhaps many of you are familiar with, like Carrie, some of the inner city schools in Vancouver, the riding I represent has the majority of the schools which have a school lunch program, one of the indices of inner city deprivation, although I know Fazil didn't like the description inner city. And what the Surrey School Board District website says is that there are many more schools are critically in need of a lunch program. And indeed, they also have what they call a snack program, a grab-and-go program, and they said those programs are in 90 of Surrey's 124 public schools, if there were more funding, it's much needed for those schools as well. So the riding I represent, I think, gives me some background and some insight into the challenges that we face. We've been asked to speak about concrete solutions. I think most of you know the context. Poverty and inequality are one of the most important political challenges we face, if not the most important. And in our platform, in our program as New Democrats in this election, we have tried to address that challenge. And the proposals that we have are as follows, an attempt to address the challenges that the previous speakers have spoken of. We have put together and propose, if elected, a family bonus program, which is an income support program that would be in addition to other programs that exist. It would support children and families by giving them an additional $60 to $70 per month per child. That would be from birth to age 18. And the income level at which that would end would be $66,000 per year family income, so just below the median. That's the first proposal. We would tie income assistance to the rate of inflation. We would double the earnings exemption for employable recipients. We would increase frontline staff at the Ministry of Children and Families. That ministry has been in crisis, and certainly Mary Ellen Turpel-Lafond has expressed in a number of very biting reports her concerns about how that ministry is operating and the degree to which it's not serving the interests of children who are living at the margins, some of them who fall into this category, but far from all of them. In addition, we would, because housing is certainly a component of poverty, we would commit to building up to 1,500 units of affordable, nonprofit, and cooperative housing for low and moderate income families. Again, a start, certainly not a solution, a total solution, but a good start. And we would reduce the fees for existing licensed care, for infant and toddler care, by 20%, saving families who qualify up to $2,000 a year. It's again a recognition that we need to take more steps to build a comprehensive system of care, but that's our first step in a program. We are conscious, and certainly in the political environment in which we operate and in a competitive political environment, that our programs have to be costed. We have to point to income sources for those programs. We've done that, but yet this is our focus, one of our focuses in the in our platform. We think that these steps can be taken, they can be done, and they're a good beginning in terms of changing the direction of policy in British Columbia. Many other provinces, not this one, have a mandate to have a child reduction or a poverty reduction program. Indeed, in Newfoundland, it was run out of the premier's office. So that was a Tory premier of Newfoundland who thought it important enough to take personal responsibility for a poverty reduction program in his province. So that's another step that we would take, and we would begin to move in those directions. So we think those are practical, affordable steps that people will embrace. And the alternative, which I expect you'll hear some of shortly, is to do nothing and to leave the child poverty rates where they are, and they're completely unacceptable. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Bruce. As advertised, a thoughtful response. Now for the rejoinder, because there's 7 more days to go for the election. So, Ralph.
Thank you, Fazil. And I would like to pay particular thanks and indicate my respect for 3 particular people, in particular President Petter, who has taken Simon Fraser. I say this as my current title, Minister of Advanced Education, Andrew. Pushing Simon Fraser into the front ranks of Canadian universities, and I say good on you. Secondly, I would like to commend Paul Kershaw for illustrating so dramatically our successes in my other ministry, the Ministry of Seniors. And I would like you to follow me around as we address seniors crowds in the remaining 7 days of this election.
Sign me up.
But in fact, he's absolutely right. If you look at the income numbers, it is astonishing the degree to which seniors are rather leading the good life. And I have seen that at first hand in my travels around British Columbia in the last 8 months as minister in charge of seniors. I thought I'd get a load of bellyaching complaints. I didn't. Life is good for seniors in British Columbia. So I think the challenge he puts out, that why can't we do the same for young people, is a perfectly valid one. And finally, I would pay my respects to my good friend Bruce Ralston. Even though we disagree on many points of policy, I really always appreciate the opportunity to share a platform with the opposition critic for finance. I just hope he hangs on to that job. So I'm pleased to contribute what I know about a very big, very important, and very complicated subject: how to raise incomes in our society, particularly for those families with children living at the bottom of the income ladder. Let's admit at the outset, the problem has many dimensions, and as Paul Kershaw and Carrie have both illustrated, quite easy to illustrate dramatically, but unfortunately there's no magic solution. For those of you who might be a tad wary or suspicious of my West Vancouver label, as perhaps you become more familiar with some of my views this evening, I would like to just point out where I'm coming from. I'm an East Vancouver kid and proud of it. Born in 1933, grew up in the Depression, the Great Depression. Our playground was boxcars on the flats. Swedish immigrant parents, lived on East 13th Avenue near Fraser, 8 kids, 2 adults, 3 bedrooms, 1 bathroom. My mother pawned her wedding ring to put food on the table. My sister told me she came home from Florence Nightingale School one day for lunch, and lunch consisted of 1 leaf of lettuce on the plate. We learned to work. We had to. The whole family pitched in. Painting business. One of our customers was the Children's Aid Society over in 10th Avenue. As we, brothers and sisters, together painted away over there, we marveled at the clients of the Children's Aid Society arriving for their appointments in taxicabs, a luxury far beyond our own experience. What did I learn from all of this? Well, I was made aware that overcoming poverty is learned at a very early age, demands hard work, is facilitated by a very supportive family, and I would say is seldom resolved permanently by handouts. The NDP seems to be promoting once more their traditional idea that since times have been good in British Columbia, and indeed they have been, under the BC Liberals, I might add, we need worry no more about baking a bigger pie and can solve the poverty mostly by redistributing the slices differently. I must protest the notion that we can easily raise money for that redistribution from taxpayers, business, and households alike, which seems to be the notion suggested that, in fact, the taxpayers are sitting there meekly like a dairy herd waiting to be milked. I hope the NDP cowboys have fast horses, because history tells us when that herd of milk cows is spooked, it has a history of stampeding for the Alberta border. So government, regardless of political persuasion, and whomever comes out on top on May the 14th, I give the message to you both without distinction. When you plan to raise taxes, and we in the BC Liberals are raising taxes as well, I freely admit, pay closer attention to the question of where high-income tax filers choose to pay their tax. Currently, the bottom 50% of tax filers pay about 3% of total provincial income taxes collected. The top 5% of tax filers pay almost half of all income tax collected. If only one percentage point of those upper income tax filers arrange their affairs so as to report their income elsewhere, that would easily wipe out the entire tax take from the bottom half of British Columbia tax filers, just to show you what I find astonishing in terms of the distribution of where we get our tax money from. So I'll have lots of other things to say about how we can work to raise incomes for all at every rung of the income of the economic ladder, but we'll save those for the question and answer period. Thank you.
Thank you, Ralph. Now that we have certainly two different points of view, at least from the political spectrum, along with the proposals that have been put forward by Paul Kershaw and seconded to a large degree by Kerry, I'm going to start off the questions period with, I'm going to go directly to the politicians because after all, they're the ones who have the levers of power, so let's see what they can do. StatsCan released its weekly wages last week. The resource sector in British Columbia pays $1,900 per week. Arts and culture, $675. The hospitality industry, $375 per week. Clearly, the sources of income is also dependent on the resource sector. Some of the higher paying jobs are in management, professional services, and civil service jobs. So essentially, if you're looking at incomes, the resource sector pays by far the highest incomes. But we are also faced in this province with a lot of people saying no to a lot of resource sector projects. But at the same time, we have the demands of Paul and Kerry and some very legitimate demands to deal with children's poverty. So the question is, as politicians, Bruce, I would like you to take this first. When you're faced with seemingly contradictory demands by the public, how do you balance, how do you make those decisions? Floor is yours.
Well, it's is this on then? Great. It's interesting that you would mention the natural resource sector. The forest industry in British Columbia was the backbone of this province for many years. Under the Liberals, it suffered a dramatic decline in terms of government revenue from $1.5 billion a year to the Treasury down to about $300 million. We have proposals to begin to revive, and that's, again, a long-term project, to revive the forest industry, to look at mining, to invest in and encourage the LNG sector, although we don't hold it out as the sole object of reverence in the way that the Liberals do in their platform. So certainly there is, and mining as well, the Liberals have, in the way in which they've managed that sector, have reduced the ability of companies simply to get basic approvals for work that they want to do on their properties, delayed by short-sighted cuts to reductions of staff that process those permits. They've made that very difficult. So there's a place for a growing and expanded resource sector in the province. In some respects, particularly in forestry and to some extent in mining, the Liberals have utterly failed on those files. So I take your point about the distribution of income, yet and wages in different sectors, but there are other areas, high-tech, tourism, all kinds of possibilities. The introduction of the HST dealt a body blow to many tourism and restaurant jobs. So the idea that somehow our approach is to attack the resource industries is simply not true. And in fact, under the Liberals, resource industries, the traditional revenue generator of much of the wealth of this province, have been substantially diminished.
Ralph, you want to respond?
Well, it will surprise no one in the audience, I suppose, that I don't really agree with my friend Bruce. It is, in many ways, the golden goose that we don't want to kill. And having earned my living in the resource industry for many years prior to politics, having run the oil and gas and mining group at the Royal Bank of Canada, having owned mining companies and being president of forestry companies myself, I do appreciate the difficulties we had in the 90s to try and get some of these projects off the ground in British Columbia. It wasn't so much the hostility as perhaps just the diffidence. They really, the people at the time that I was dealing with perhaps didn't give the impression they really cared too much. I suppose Bruce would bring a different flavor to that assignment. I agree. But this capital is very nervous, and it has lots of different places to go in the world. We have no lock on natural resources, for that matter, even wood fiber. So if statements are made saying, no, we're not going to build that Kinder Morgan line, 10 days after a statement is being made saying, I am a man of principle, we will wait to see what the studies suggest first before making a decision. Everybody, it's like a lightning jab in the rear end to the folks trying to figure out whether to trust in the long term a new government. So even though I think Bruce does make the case that at the core, the party he represents does appreciate where the money comes from, the behavior of his colleagues has already frightened people, and we will pay the price. These people don't have to invest in British Columbia. It's very mobile, and I'm afraid that to some degree the damage has already been done.
With respect, gentlemen, both of you did not answer the question that I posed. So let me try again. The question was, the British Columbia public seems to demand that their grandmother's hip be replaced in 3 months, not 3 years. That classrooms should be 20 students and no more. We need to build more social housing. We need to have more legal aid. We need to have breakfast programs. That's the demand. At the same time, though, money doesn't fall from heaven. It needs to be created. And on that front, we have a whole bunch of British Columbians saying no to a lot of money-generating, income-generating, living wage jobs. How do you, as a politician, when faced with those two demands, how do you deal with it in a cabinet setting? What would you say to somebody who says to you, listen, we don't want these three, there are 17 mines in the EA process right now north of Kamloops, right? So if they say, no, we don't want those mines, at the same time they ask you, you know what, my grandmother needs more help. Bruce, what would you say to that constituent?
Well, I don't think the choice that you make is quite so stark. Certainly there are some projects that have not earned social license. Northern Gateway Pipeline, for example, is something that our party has taken a clear position on. And it's not because the people of the North Coast oppose economic development. They have a different conception of economic development. The Haisla Nation, for example, took a referendum on an LNG project in which they are participants. That referendum passed with over 80% approval. So there are other kinds of jobs on the North Coast that use the natural resources in a different way, whether it's fishing, whether it's other industries that would benefit from the natural environment of the North Coast. So the choice isn't as stark as you say, and certainly not every project automatically should go forward. The other thing I would say is that there are reserves of capital. You speak of capital, and my colleague Ralph has spoken of nervous capital, but there are also pools of socially responsible capital that are looking to invest in jurisdictions like British Columbia, where there's great natural beauty, where there's a respect for the environment, where labor standards are met, and in fact is patient capital and would welcome the opportunity to invest in British Columbia. So I don't think it's an either-or choice. There are other sources of capital that would be and are pleased to invest in British Columbia.
Thank you, Kerry and Paul. I haven't forgotten about you. I'll come back to you immediately. But Ralph, if you can answer that question in response to Bruce without going into the speaking notes of the campaign, that will be appreciated.
Well, let me try again. Thanks for the second chance. The dilemma, the hypothetical situation you present is, in fact, not very hypothetical at all. All politicians from all parties face that situation frequently. Many passionate constituents say, no bloody way to this, no bloody way to that. But we do know, and we have access to the budget figures frequently, much more so than the general public, if we are going to cut class sizes, if we're going to have a hot lunch program for every child in British Columbia, if we're going to put more resources into special needs, and on and on and on, it's going to take a lot of money. I think the responsible politician does what he or she thinks is in the public interest. And in that case, as long as these projects pass environmental review and have a social license, we need them, and they will be promoted. And I think that's a fair approximation of what this BC Liberal government has tried to do.
Thank you. This is a question for Kerry as well as for Paul. There seems to be specific problems beyond, I mean, Kerry, you went into a whole slew of problems beyond just the money. Let me give you one specific problem which Jerry Bellett, one of our reporters and who has been helping with Adopt a School, reported on. A South Asian community, I mean, it's not in a particular school, there is not the food that is a problem, it's not as if they're not dressed for school. But they're simply not prepped for kindergarten coming in. I mean, they don't know how to read. They don't know how to turn a page of a book. Parents are at work, both working for an income. The grandparents are looking after the kids. They have no language capacity. So they come into K already way behind. And that leads to all the nervousness and, of course, self-esteem amongst others. What do you do? What's the practical solution? What do you do in that particular situation? How do you intervene? If so, how?
This question's for me.
Sure.
There's the response of what we do at school, which is we do it because we don't have a choice, and these kids arrive to us, and we get on with it. But the question, I think, here tonight is the bigger issue of what do we do and what do we think is right to do as a society. And That to me is the big question. I think in all of the discussion that I just heard, I got a bit confused with horses and golden geese and stuff. But I think that general public, when you ask them, want things to be more just. Like Paul said, a lot of the policy around this New Deal for Families is not just about benefiting kids that are in poverty, it's about benefiting all kids. And it's just like what we do in the classroom. When we do good teaching practice that benefits our kids that have special needs, it benefits all of our kids. And people do want and are willing to have things changed in terms of their taxes if it's going to actually go into things that are going to make the inequity in BC less. And so we are looking at things like childcare that's quality childcare that's available for families, that they're not panicking about staying. For a lot of our families, it's about mom works all day and dad works all night and they switch off and we've got parents napping, and these kinds of things are just not okay. So families need to feel secure that we're supporting. It's structures and support. And it's also around all of the early intervention piece like you're talking about. And so how do we decide to have priorities around that?
Paul, programmatically, how would you deal with a household or households which have this particular problem that they're not prepped to come to care? What do you do?
This is a far broader issue in our province of British Columbia and across the country than the difficulties of a particular minority of the cultural community. I mean, we do have the data that show us about 30% of kids wind up at our kindergarten programs each year struggling in ways that we wouldn't want them to struggle. Don't know 10 letters, can't hold a pencil, can't get along with peers on the playground, show enough respect to a teacher in the classroom. The majority of those kids who are struggling, they don't reside in poor neighborhoods, in poor homes. They reside in middle and upper income households and neighborhoods. And the question is, how has that struggle seeped into the majority? And then we just need to go back to the squeeze that I was describing that is now impacting entire generations of young people, Gens X and Y, who are raising young kids. Their wages are down, so their coping mechanism is let's devote more time to the labor market, which is a good coping strategy. But it can't keep up with housing prices that are far, far higher. And it poses costs at home in terms of the time that they have there. Now, the greater time in the labor market has been good for gender equality for women, but it hasn't been matched by having a more male time at home. And so we need to figure out, how do we simultaneously invest in services like childcare that could, in some communities, be provided in minority ethno-cultural languages and facilitate exposure to English? And simultaneously, how do we invest in families to have enough time at home, men and women alike, so that collectively we reduce that early vulnerability?
Thank you. I know I have lots of questions, but I am going to go to audience because this is a public forum, and Shauna has the microphone. And Shauna, are you going to Sharon Gregson? Sharon, can you introduce yourself and then ask the question, please?
Happy to. Sharon Gregson, child care advocate. So it's many people will know that there's something called the $10 a day child care plan, which has been resonating across the province and now has a list of supporters which number and represent over 1.6 million British Columbians, people who want affordable, accessible, not-for-profit child care delivered through the Ministry of Education, through our public education system. So I'm curious to hear from our two political candidates at the table what they specifically are doing, what's in their platform that will reduce the incredibly high parent fees that parents are paying now and their plans to build more spaces. I want to know what they are going to do to start us building a child care system in this province.
Bruce?
Well, thanks very much, Sharon. And I know Sharon is a passionate advocate for $10 a day child care, and familiar with the campaign that has been led publicly, and it's been a very strong and effective campaign. What we have said we would do as a first step would be to reduce fees for existing licensed infant and toddler care, which is the most expensive care, by 20%. That would save families about an average of $2,000 a year, and we would increase the number of spaces. We would also repurpose, if that's a verb, the fund that was set up by Mr. Campbell as Premier, putting in $1,000 at the birth of a child to be given to them at age 18. Not a lot was known about that. The Liberals in their platform converted that to something else. We would use that money to set up a series of programs in early learning and child care. And use that as a fund to draw resources to begin to create the kind of system that you speak of.
Ralph?
The discussion earlier described all the wonderful things we would like to do if we had the resources to do them. But, of course, being government, in fact, being in the opposition, is a matter of making choices. I've done private research which strongly supports the notion that one of the major causes of low-income families in British Columbia is, in fact, what might, with a little bit of sexual bias, I suppose, be called the single mom issue. Well, the single parent issue then. Statistically, this is a very powerful predictor of the incidence of low-income families with children across British Columbia, and I'd be glad to go into the rather large-scale research project I did to demonstrate that to my own satisfaction. So there's no question of the power on the income side of parenting really inhibiting access to the labor market, and of course daycare would greatly facilitate that. It really comes down to money and choices and how's it going to be paid for. I don't think anybody can credibly argue against it in principle. I think it will come in time. It's certainly not in our budget this year, and it's certainly not anything promised in the platform. But again, I would repeat that the all-day kindergarten, $500 million a year, which is a great breakthrough championed by Gordon Campbell. The Strong Start program has, I think, proven its merit at very low cost. And there are other child-oriented activities. In fact, as I pointed out, perhaps if you add it all up, we have about $4 billion, almost, of resources directed to lower-income families with children in this government, almost 10% of the entire budget, for goodness sake. So it is not as though this sector is being ignored, far from it. But you're quite right. We do not have an articulated plan that I'm aware of. Perhaps some people in the education ministry do, but I have not been made aware of it at this time.
Paul, can you respond, please?
Yeah, I think one of the really important words that Ralph used was choices, and both political parties and citizens every day are making these choices. And so one of the common themes that we've heard tonight is that the cupboard is bare. The cupboard's not available to invest big dollars in new programs. But hands up in the room, do you think $1.5 billion of spending is big bucks? Hands up, anyone? I think it's big dollars. In both the NDP and the Liberal platforms going into this election, they both are campaigning on inviting us to spend an extra $1.5 billion on medical care for my 97-year-old grandmother and my mother, people I love and adore. But they're saying that same $1.5 billion is not available to invest in something like $10 a day child care services. And so I want to know, and my mom wants to know, and my grandmother wants to know, why are our two main political parties asking us to vote for platforms that are literally pitting the health of grandmothers against the well-being of their kids and grandchildren? That's a choice both platforms are making, and they're inviting us to then make it as well.
Okay, Paul, you have made it very succinctly, so I think I'll have to go back to Bruce again and ask him why they made those choices. Bruce.
Well, I'm not sure that that's the right way to pose the choice. And I mean, it certainly has a certain, appeal in presenting it. But the reality of healthcare is that I don't see how one can say to seniors or people in need of care that you're going to end care or reduce care dramatically, and I'm not sure that's what is being put forward. So there are certain obligations that society has come to expect in terms of medicine. I don't think it's any secret that as one gets older, your need for medical care increases. But what we have tried to do in our platform is begin to address exactly what you talk about, and the program that I've spoken of, the Family Bonus Program, is an income support program for largely middle-class people and people who are working but are working at low-paid service jobs. Sometimes the problem isn't an absence of a job, but the fact that you're working and you're not being paid that much. So we are attempting to address that. Our infant toddler program that I've just spoken of is another effort to begin to build the kind of system that you do. But in order to, by posing it in the way you do, I fear that you might invite a political backlash because it's a rather, in my view, unfortunate way to phrase the choice.
Thank you, Bruce. There's another question from the floor. So, Shauna, can you?
Hi there. My name is Lisa Waring, and I'm the provincial coordinator for Breakfast for Learning here in British Columbia. Breakfast for Learning has been funding school breakfast, lunch, and snack programs for over 20 years across this country. It might interest the audience and the panel to know that Canada is the only G8 country that does not have a national school meal program. Now, I'm hearing a lot of interesting ideas here today about raising income levels for those living below the poverty line. Those are great long-term strategies, and I really applaud those. But my focus right now is that tomorrow morning at 8:15 in the morning, 31% of elementary school kids and 62% of secondary school kids are going to walk into their schools hungry tomorrow. And that's regardless of whether they're coming from single-parent households or the working poor. Now, there are many stakeholders working really hard in this province to try and alleviate this issue, including the Adopt-a-School program from the Vancouver Sun, Breakfast for Learning, Breakfast Clubs of Canada, a lot of small grassroots stakeholders. We're all over the place with this. And to mangle an old adage, it's going to take a little bit more than a village to solve this problem. It's going to take a province. Now,
you'll have to pose a question
yes.
to either of the two.
So in light of all of this, we have an election next week, and I would like to know particularly what Mr. Ralston and Mr. Sultan would consider, if they would consider creating a task force, a provincial task force, to address the issue of a provincial school meal program, and not just write a report, but put some verbs in their sentences so that we can quite literally feed the success of BC's children.
Ralph, the floor is yours.
I'd love to, and I'd like to work with Bruce and you on that task force. I have had some familiarity with going back to my old grade school, Florence Nightingale, there at 12th and Kingsway. And, of course, they have a huge demand for meals, not just in school days, but on the weekends as well. They have a backpack program. I'm sure you're familiar with these things. So it isn't as though these activities are not carried on, but it's a very, it seems to me, disjointed, fragmented, and sporadic activity, funded in part by neighborhood collections, which really astounded me. And it's ironic that we're in the David Malafagian Auditorium, I believe, and David Malafagian himself called me over about 6 months ago, wanting to know all about this issue, because he was very concerned about children coming to school hungry. So here's one of the great philanthropists of British Columbia showing a lot of interest. So I gave him what information I had. So yes, it's a no-brainer. And while, task forces come and go, I'd be glad to seriously work on it with you, as long as Bruce comes with me.
Okay, can I? Bruce, go ahead and answer.
Right. Back back when Premier Harcourt came into power, the issue of having a lunch program in schools was at that time controversial. I think then Premier Van Der Zandt attacked parents as being lazy because they didn't make lunch for their kids. So that was a program that was instituted by the government then, and it's stood the test of time. Certainly, I'm familiar in my part of Surrey with a breakfast program where, and part of the problem is if you don't get a good start in the day, you don't come to school, absenteeism increases, your chances for success in school diminish. And so there are specific programs, mostly funded charitably, which help get kids to school and get a good start, have something to eat, and then be in a mood and in a frame of mind where you can focus on learning. So I think that's again another step that would be an important one in terms of tackling this big problem that we're talking about tonight.
Thank you. There's Jill. I think Jill Shaw has a question.
Yes, thank you, Ralph. I took your point that you seem to attribute a lot of the problems that we're talking here tonight about child poverty to single mothers, but I have to say with our Adopt-a-School program, the children that we've met and I think as Carrie can tell you, come from families of all types, not just single parents, not just people on welfare who may take a cab to collect a service, as you noticed when you were growing up. And what we would like to know, and I think that Lisa's advice to verbs in the sentence is not, is really your answer to this is, I'm sorry, there is no money and there will be no food for these children. Or will your party, if it is successful in this election, actually take on this problem and not leave it to donations that come in the hope that people can scrape together some food to feed the children?
Ralph.
Well, let me respond to the first part of your statement by pointing out I identified single parents strictly as an economist looking at the numbers. And I did spend about 8 or 9 months and a good deal of research assistant time in Victoria building a very elaborate, by my standards at least, multivariate model of the correlates of communities that have a high incidence of reported low-income families with children. And two variables popped out to a degree quite incredible in a cross-section study of this type: the percentage of single parents in that community and the percentage of immigrants in that community, which to me is a powerful clue as to what's going on socially in that community. And while no one, I'm sure, would decry the competence and dedication and capacity of single parents to raising their children, the economics of the situation seem to suggest that when it comes to having livable family incomes, they are frequently below the low-income cutoff. It's just a statistical fact without a value judgment attached to it. And the same thing applies to the percentage of immigrants, which is in itself a rather large subject, to say the least. So I'm just reporting the facts, ma'am, without any value judgments. As to whether I can commit today to rewrite the platform upon which this party's been running around the province for, the better part of 6 months, selling and a budget that's been presented and debated in the House in the next 7 days, it ain't going to happen. Doesn't mean to say that my heart isn't there, and I'd be glad to continue working with you, as I've already indicated.
Thank you, Ralph. Anne.
Is this working? Good evening. Scott Clark with Aboriginal Life and Vancouver Enhancement. Having had a chance to look at both the platforms, I don't see that there's a really meaningful choice for really empowering vulnerable children and families throughout all the province. Most of the work we do is here in the city. Carrie, you mentioned the word place-based strategies. But one of the key things that I see with provincial governments and even the federal governments is that meaningful choice for me as a citizen here in Vancouver means finding innovative ways between working with the federal, the provincial government, the municipal, the school board, and the parks board. I don't see that anywhere in either of your platforms, and that disturbs me quite a bit, because the cutting-edge research is around place-based strategies, which really empowers immigrants, low-income, and urban Aboriginal people. I'd like to know if you have any thoughts on that. Thank you very much.
Carrie, you want to take that one first?
Did you want these guys to address it?
Yes. Sorry, Bruce. I can address Bruce, it. I think the response is required from you.
Well, the fund that I spoke of earlier has about $300 million in it. That is the fund from which we would draw resources to engage in some of these innovations in the area of childcare. And certainly, there are opportunities that could be explored and should be explored, and that's the basis on which those could go forward. So there is a source of funds. There is a commitment to use that $300 million to begin and to build that kind of program, along with some of the other steps that I've pointed out earlier.
Can I just put some context to the Aboriginal students? Certainly, the graduation rates have improved in the last 10 years because there's been some cutting-edge work which has gone on here, and there have been so many successful programs across this province. That's the good news. The bad news is still the graduation rates are still some of the worst when compared with the mainstream population. What do you carry from a classroom perspective? What do we need to do to improve? I mean, it's not just a moral imperative. It is also an economic imperative that we get Aboriginal students to reach for the stars. So can you shed some light on what we could do on a classroom basis?
Well, the school where I teach right now, our Aboriginal population is 45%. When I started teaching at Seymour 18 years ago, we used to say that we had sort of a third of Cantonese, some Mandarin-speaking students, a third Vietnamese, a third everything else, your Caucasian students, Aboriginal students from Latin America, Africa. Now our population is 45%. I think that we need to, and I appreciate the comment, Scott, because the really effective work is within communities, and when you have to look at what your community is dealing with. And it's also issues of concentrated poverty. I mean, we haven't really touched a lot of stuff around social housing. And while I am a big advocate that there needs to be more units, the way that we are organizing social housing is, I don't have an appropriate word to use, because it's concentrated poverty. And there's a lot of really powerful single moms who kick some of these people's butts around being very vocal around their issues and their issues for their kids. And I think it's about inviting parents into our schools, how we are a welcoming community, how we are having parent voice, how we are allowing them to talk about what their kids need and how we best serve it. It's about getting our kids reading. We don't get them reading, we're doomed. At our school, we do that very, very well, tiny as we are and limited as we are. But it really is around accessing service that moms can get to and families can get to, because for a lot of times it is a situation where you don't have a car and the service is across the town and how are you going to get your kids on the bus, et cetera, et cetera. So it's locating it within the community and allow community to drive it and bringing that voice and that feeling of connectedness into our schools.
Paul.
I think an important part of truth and reconciliation in British Columbia and all of Canada is to do the reverse of the residential school system. The residential school system removed children from their family homes, robbing those parents and grandparents of the opportunity to instill pride in their identity and language. The residential school system removed children from their community context, robbing the community of the opportunity to support that family, to instill pride in their culture and their identity and their language. Which is why something like the Generation Squeeze campaign and the New Deal for Families that Carrie was talking about says, let's organize policy across the province and across the country, building on the wisdom that Aboriginal people can tell us as a result of that residential school experience. Let's invest more in family time, which in the context of Aboriginal families will give them greater opportunity to instill that pride in identity and in language. And simultaneously, let's invest in services like childcare well before kids get to school, so that the community, those community services can support parents with that work. And on reserve, we can have services that expose children to their first languages and help parents pass on that pride in the cultural identity. And we can do the same thing for off-reserve Aboriginals.
So am I hearing this right? Clearly, kids between the ages of 3 to 5 need, I mean, there is a very crucial time from all the research. So you're telling us, the argument that you're making is, correct me if I'm wrong, is that if you create childcare spaces where it's learning centers, so to speak, I mean, just childcare, that would solve some of the prep for the kids coming into kindergarten? Is that the solution that you're promoting?
Well, there's just oodles.
At least one part of the solution.
Yeah, oodles and oodles of evidence that if we don't let kids get off to a good start, here I'm channeling Clyde Hertzman, I mean, we are going to be compromising their school success, compromising their opportunities to have a good health throughout their lives, increasing the rate at which they go into jail. Or we could get it right for kids, but getting it right for kids means getting it right for the generation raising them. And the generation raising them is squeezed for time, it is squeezed for income because wages aren't doing what we might like despite all the growth, and they're squeezed for services like childcare. So we can't just pick one. We have to actually have a multifaceted approach to address the time, income, and service squeeze.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Michael McCarthy Flynn. I work with an organization called First Call, and every year we bring out the Child Poverty Report Card. And for many years, it went into a vacuum. We're very glad that SFU and the Vancouver Sun is covering this, and it is finally making its way up the political agenda. My question is, though, around low wages. It amazes me how little is talked about low wages, and when we do talk about low wages, how it's dismissed as if there's nothing we can do about it. Not many people might know, but the main cause of child poverty in our province is actually low wages. 43% of parents or children living in poverty have parents working full-time, full year, and a large majority or a significant majority have parents working in some type of job. So the single most important policy change that we need to make is to reduce our low-wage sector. Now, this won't be done just by increasing training. It won't be done by having every high-end mining company. Even if we had every resource sector come in, it doesn't reduce the low-end sector. What changes that is choices that we make. As a public sector and as an institution like SFU, we have the power to make those choices. So my question to you, Bruce, would be, we have a living wage campaign at the moment ongoing in SFU. We're asking them to become the first university in Canada to be a living wage university to ensure that everybody who works there and who is contracted to work there, including the people who have cleaned this beautifully manicured auditorium today, aren't people who are earning $12 or $13 an hour, so they are in the squeeze that is talked about, so their children aren't living in poverty. My question would be to you, will you ensure that education services have enough funding so they can pay everybody a living wage?
Bruce.
Well, I think the crucial thing of what you said was particularly... The crucial thing that you said was contracted services. I think less full-time staff are and those represented by a union, and I know my colleague Ralph has different views on the benefits of unionism in terms of its equality-inducing effects and the ability of organized workers to increase their wages. But leaving that aside, certainly... people who work for contract, part-time, contingent labor are the most vulnerable in the workforce, and you're right, they tend to be the lowest paid, and that is part of the problem. We have looked at the Liberal budget. We found the figures, despite the claim that it's balanced, to be unrealistic. We have somewhat controversially, but certainly been attacked for saying that the rate of increase of spending of the Liberal government and its budget is not something that's sustainable without massive cuts across the board. So what I'm prepared to say is that given the importance of public institutions of higher learning in the province, that we will do our very best to ensure that they get the financial resources that's necessary to carry out all their obligations, including what I regard as all their social obligations, that is to treat all the staff and those who work for them fairly.
Andrew, you heard some good news there. Shauna.
Hi, is this on? Hi, my name is Matt Hearn. I'm a former Vancouver School principal and school trustee. It's an axiom that hungry kids don't learn. And I don't get the sense of immediacy or urgency about the issue of breakfast programs for kids. You've heard from the representative of Breakfast Clubs of Canada or Breakfast for Learning. There are two organizations in this country, Breakfast Clubs of Canada and Breakfast for Learning, that provide help to 350 schools across this province. That's roughly 15,000 kids who arrive in school hungry. I don't get the sense of immediacy or urgency. Hungry kids don't learn, and that's a fact of life. Now, what are we going to do about it? I thank the Vancouver Sun for its adopted school program and organizing the forum. But the point about this is, today's Sun, by the way, carries a story about Champlain Heights Elementary School, ostensibly in a middle-class area, southeast Vancouver.
Right beside it, another school, Captain James Cook School. Again, ostensibly a middle-class area. Poverty has spread from the inner city right across the city, and documented, by the way, by UBC, the geography department. So we're talking about not just hidden poverty, but increasing child poverty. And move across the border to Burnaby. How about 12th Street School, where the principal and teacher, in tears, feeding kids a breakfast program. How do they feed them? From Costco and Walmart. Give me a break. That's a bloody disgrace in a province as rich as this province. What are we going to do about it? I don't get the sense of urgency or emergency from anybody in this panel about this issue. Let's do something about it, folks. Next September, you will have 350 schools, rural and urban, opening up with that problem. They should not have to depend on a Toronto-based and Montreal-based Breakfast or Learning or Breakfast Clubs of Canada. Let's do something about it.
Thank you very much. Before I go to the panel, a couple of points of clarification. As far as Captain Cook Elementary goes, the Chancellor of Simon Fraser University, Carol Taylor, and her husband, late husband, decided to fund the breakfast program for the next 5 years to take care of that problem. Clearly, as far as Champlain Heights goes, there is a need for... I mean, specifically to deal with 60 or 70 children who are coming to Captain Cook without breakfast, that cost has been taken care of. Now, as far as Champlain Heights goes, there is about, apparently it cost about $15,000 to feed those kids who are coming in per year. So we have again gone to the public to ask for help. These are all stopgap measures. Clearly, there needs to be a systemic approach to dealing with kids who are coming with no breakfast. I mean, heck, I am cranky if I haven't had anything to eat. I don't know how people are going to learn when they come into school without breakfast. So, Bruce, is this notion that somehow there are all these kids coming to school without a breakfast program, has anybody done any calculation about what it would cost to have a program such as that across the province?
Well, I'm not aware of specific calculation, but I do want to just at least acknowledge the point that Noel has made about a sense of urgency, and perhaps if that wasn't conveyed by members of the panel, I think everyone here would share, and maybe have not communicated it well enough, a sense of urgency about this problem. The point that you make about a stopgap system, is the crucial point. What's necessary is a systematic approach. I don't quarrel with private charity, and certainly those are highly motivated people who are doing good work, but the problem, I think, is that it becomes very patchy, and sometimes people's fate or the fate of individual children or areas depends upon the vagaries of giving, which sometimes are not entirely satisfactory. So a systematic approach, build a better system, and I think that's what we've set out in our platform, and that's the direction that we would want to go. We wouldn't be able to do everything all at once, but that's the direction that we can go and should go and will go if we get the chance.
Paul.
I think we need to feel an even greater sense of urgency. I think we need to feel a kind of urgency that would say, let's put breakfast programs out of business. Let's actually not go to the place of trying to deal with the problem after the fact. Let's go and address the sources of the problem. I think so many people in this room sometimes think too narrowly, too small, dream bigger. I showed you, we reduced poverty among seniors by 3/4. We didn't do that by dreaming narrowly and thinking about the breakfast program for seniors. We did it by dreaming big and thinking about what programs can we put in place to ensure those seniors don't go bankrupt when they're sick and they don't live nearly the kind of rates of income insecurity that they used to.
Bruce, do you have, is there enough time now to get Paul into a seat to run for the next election? Just kidding.
I think nominations have closed.
Closed.
But I think he's on a permanent campaign anyway, so.
Paul, go ahead, finish.
So I do think that in this room we need to feel a greater sense of urgency for asking for more than simply dealing with the problem after the fact. And I would encourage you to leave tonight knowing we've had great success at reducing similar problems for different generations, and we can do it again for younger generations if only we bring the same commitment. And people may be a wee bit uncomfortable about trading off medical care
investments versus investments in younger people. But I heard Bruce say, and I think I am quoting, we don't want to turn people away who need care when they go to the hospital. Why are we turning away kids who need care well before they get to school? And if you don't like that trade-off, then what else won't we build? Or how might we pay more taxes? Those are the things that we need to think about more and ask our people building the platforms to reflect different alternatives, because they are building platforms that cater to those of us who go and vote.
Thank you, Paul. Em, you have a question here, right?
Hi, Adrienne Montani with First Call. I just want to echo that I think we should be dreaming big, because charity creates inequity. Some people get the attention of the charitable and some don't. So we do need the public policy response. I want to return to what my colleague Michael said about most, we do the poverty report card every year. We know that most of the poor kids in this province have parents who work. We do need those solutions on wages, on employment standards that make vulnerable people keep crappy jobs because that's all because they can't unionize anymore. There's a bunch of pieces to this picture that we need to look at. But particularly, we have to keep looking upstream. Why do kids come to school hungry? Because their parents are poor. Why are their parents poor? Because they can't get childcare to go to work, or if they can, it costs them a university degree or more, and so they can't work. Or because they can't get the education they need. We have a welfare system that doesn't let people go to school to get out of the out of welfare. So there's so many pieces to this policy menu that we need. We need a comprehensive poverty reduction plan for this province that brings across ministries all the things that are working at cross purposes that trap people in on welfare, don't let them go to school, don't let them work because they can't get childcare or break the bank if they do. So we need that comprehensive plan and sets, and we want it legislated because we want to see some targets and some timelines about did we do it? No, not this year. What do we need to do next year? That's called a business plan. So that's what we need.
Thanks, Adrienne. Ralph, do you want to take that on first, and then I'll go to Bruce?
Ralph. Sorry, I didn't quite understand.
Do you want to go answer that question first? I'll come back to you. Bruce.
Yeah, please do. I've lost the train of your question. Okay. I'm sorry.
Okay. Bruce. As I said earlier, in our platform in black and white is a commitment to introduce a legislated poverty reduction strategy with targets and timelines. Our critic Shane Simpson, who's the MLA for Vancouver Hastings, running again, introduced just that private member's bill. Wasn't adopted by the government, but certainly there is a commitment on our side to do just what you've said and to look across government at the ways in which resources can be mobilized with that goal in mind in the long run.
Can I ask, show of hands, here's a question, so that we can go back to the politicians. Resource sector jobs pay about $110,000, $115,000 average annually. Give me a show of hands, because you all support all the demands which are the legitimate demands that Paul and Kerry have laid out on the table. If there are appropriate environmental safeguards and they pass the environmental safeguards and have social license, show of hands as to how many of you in favor of. There are $30 billion of mining projects over the next 10 years which are in play, which will bring in $30 billion, which of course means a lot of government revenues to spend on all the things which Paul's talking about. How many of you here are in favor of such an approach? Appropriate environmental safeguards, but resource development. All right. Now, Ralph.
Well, Fazil more or less stole my speech. You know, the legislators in Victoria are not evil people. They are not deliberately going out to send children to school in the morning without food. They are not deliberately setting out to do harm. In my experience, and I've been over there 12 years, they are, almost without exception, very well-intentioned, public-minded people who want to do the best thing for British Columbia and its citizens. If it was as easy as passing a law, let us say raising the minimum wage to $25, and if there was any sensible hope that would actually accomplish the purpose intended, I think that law would pass unanimously in the legislature. But it comes up against the reality of the economy in which this government is embedded. We only have so much money we can collect through taxes. There are limitations to how high we can raise the tax rate, and many debates about how high that might be. We operate on the basis of things we make and sell to one another, but also to the rest of the world. So it's very easy for us to sit here and say, I think we should do that, and by the way, let's do that as well, and hey, let's not forget about so-and-so. We should be spending equal time to trying to deduce how on earth we're going to organize our economic arrangements to produce the revenue to pay for it all. The government of Victoria doesn't print the money, nor for that matter does the Bank of Canada. We have to pay our way somehow. And I think Fazil is sort of pushing and cajoling and nudging us to say, well, are we not willing to put up with a few resource projects as one means of partially paying for some of this stuff? I think that's the game he's playing, not very subtly in my view. I happen to agree with him 100%. I find it a bit discouraging that people make these great speeches about stuff we should do, but they do not seem prepared to discuss what perhaps would they be willing to give up to substitute this new activity, or perhaps if it's new, a brand new one, how we're going to generate some new sources of revenue to pay for it.
Shauna.
Hi, my name is Helen Ward. I am a low-income single mother. I've been so for about 18 years. I'm a hard-working low-income single mother, like pretty much all mothers. I'm also the president of Kids First Parent Association of Canada. I have a platform outlined here, if you'd like to look at that, for some different suggestions about some of these concerns. If you're passionate about family income, may I suggest to some of you, including Paul Kershaw, who earns something like $100,000 a year from UBC, that you advocate for a reduction in your share of the pie so that can be shared with others. Because the problem is a power imbalance between parents and pretty much everybody else. I'd like to talk about work and childcare. Parental childcare is work. So when you say they need work, well, parental childcare is a form of work. I'd like to know why, what do you have against parents? 18 months, Paul, an 18-month-old child is a very tiny creature, a very vulnerable creature. According to Dr. Gordon Neufeld and pretty much all the hard peer-reviewed evidence out there, this child will be best off with their parents or people the parents personally choose. Why don't we finance families directly? Financing all these services will not actually increase our income. You want to increase income, take that child care, child development, early learning funding, and provide it to families, and we will choose how to use that. What do you have against parents spending time with their children? What do you have against the definition of work and childcare that honor this work?
Paul, the floor is yours.
Well, I'm surprised the question came to me. Have people not heard that I have simultaneously been emphasizing the need for us to make it affordable for parents to have more time at home while we simultaneously invest in services that facilitate them to have enough time in the labor market to deal with wages that are going down and costs of living are going up? I am one of the loudest advocates, along with my colleagues Linnell Anderson and Kasson up there, Kasson Elliott, who we at the Jan Squeeze campaign are some of the loudest advocates in this country to invest more in making it affordable for parents to have time at home. And we just don't think it's an either or. We can also do that while simultaneously investing in the services that families need. And okay, we can go from there.
All right. Thank you. I have run out of time for questions. I want to finish on time. I value your time. Each of our panelists have been given 2 minutes to close their presentations. So I'll start this time with Ralph. Ralph, you have 2 minutes to say your piece.
From here?
Yes, you can say it from
there. 2 minutes. Carrying on in the same vein, I suppose I'm being repetitive. The economic model underlying government actions on poverty is very simple. When the economy expands, confidence grows, businesses are encouraged, and individuals are encouraged to spend more money. Jobs are created, money flows back to the government in the way of tax revenue. With more money, the government can expand services and do a lot more for everybody, including programs to address and alleviate poverty. The opposite is also true. When spending by business and individual falters, the government's revenues dry up, jobs disappear, the demand for social services climb, but the money to pay for it diminishes. The number of households with low incomes grows by leaps and bounds. This is the simple but true economic model of what goes up and what goes down. So my plea to this very passionate and, I must say, on the ground, very informed group, I commend you, and I commend the vigor with which you express yourselves, should be very nervous about the growing frequency of no to economic-generating, job-generating, revenue-generating activities in our society, because they are the sources of the money to pay for all the wonderful suggestions that have been made here this evening. That is no way to dispel the genuine social concern of childhood poverty in our society and the capacity of the government to alleviate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ralph. Paul.
Oh, great. Let me paint a picture of a worrisome pattern. If you're a Gen X or Y, you're making lower wages today and paying higher costs of living than a generation ago. The amount of spending that happens from governments on you is about one quarter of what it is for older generations. You inherit municipal, provincial, and federal debts that are nearly twice as large as a share of our economy as did your parents a generation ago. And environmentally, we used to be one of the three worst polluters of carbon dioxide per person on the planet in 1976. We pretty much still are. And yet it is younger people who inherit the risks of global climate change. So to Fazil's point, there is not a party or government on the planet that would not be thinking very seriously about the natural gas resources that we have in this province and how to use them. The question before us is, how might we go about using them in ways that don't exacerbate the environmental harm younger people are disproportionately inheriting, and do so in a way that doesn't ensure that, despite all the growth it will produce, leave younger people with larger debts inherited municipally, provincially, and federally, and give rise to social spending patterns that seem to say the cupboard is bare for younger generations when it's not necessarily for others. We need younger people to start speaking out and saying we don't have such a great generational deal in this province or this country, and we need their boomers and senior parents and grandparents to get on board for a better generational deal for all.
Thank you, Paul. Carrie.
Well, I really want to thank the audience for the really impressive, articulate comments, the passion that people are speaking tonight, and everybody's participation. So thank you. I want to end here tonight with where I begin every day, which is in the classroom with kids. And I'm speaking again about this issue of vulnerability. Children who live in poverty are arriving to school too vulnerable, and they're going to remain that vulnerable unless we insist that government adopts social and family policy. The answer, some of these platforms, it's jobs. It's not jobs unless it's jobs that's going to pay a living wage and childcare that parents can secure and afford, and then that would be a piece. Growing the economy, growing the economy, growing the economy doesn't ensure any commitment to policy changes, and I think that's an important point. Poverty is structurally created. It's structures that are going to get us out of it. And this means expecting government to commit and implement policies that will make a difference and mean that children are not so stressed with issues of housing and proper nutrition and all of those things that impact their lives, and that their parents have more time with them and that they have access to all of these learning opportunities. These children aren't statistics. They're not election promises. They're important beings that are on their route to the rest of their lives, to their future education, training, new experiences, adulthood, parenthood, careers, happiness. We can't press pause and maybe get to it in these kids' lives. Our kids grow like this. Kids are growing. We need to do something about it. We know it. So what are we going to do?
Thank you, Carrie.
And last but not least, potentially our next new finance minister, Mr. Ralston.
Thanks very much. In my riding, I've only had one all-candidates debate, and the Liberal didn't bother to come. So this has been refreshing for me in the sense that there is a Liberal perspective. I'm disappointed it's so gloomy and so negative. We can do this. We have a rich province. We can build a strong, sustainable economy with a vibrant middle class, and we can begin to tackle these age-old problems. We've set out in our platform first steps that are affordable, practical, and doable, and we have more, lots more ideas, and certainly people in this room have lots more to contribute. So we can do this. We can tackle this problem. I have a great sense of optimism about our ability to do this in the future. So thanks very much for the exchange, and let's collectively set out to solve this problem.
Thank you. Hold on. M. Johal will come up here to, formally thank the panel, but let me say a couple of words about SFU's public forum and the people who work there. Shauna Sylvester, Janet Weber, M. Johal, Jackie, who is here in front of me. Because President Petter is here, I should say it in front of him, this is a dream team to work with. They are superb at what they do. They have made my life so much easy putting this event together. I'm just a pretty face here. There was a lot of work which went on. So thank you very much.